Ladies and gentlemen, I am Stacey A. Cross, and there is no E in my name, and I'm with a guest over the pond today, coming in live from the UK, Fab Poli, Fabrizio Poli, but for this, we're going to call him Fab today. Fab is the managing partner, founder, and CEO of Tyrus Wings. Now, Tyrus Wings manages a fleet of private jets. Am I correct, Fab?
Yeah, correct, yes.
So a fleet of private jets, not only, you know, one of your goals is to get your private jet by the end of this year or next year, but you're also a pilot in your previous life. So you come in with that whole wings mentality, get your stripes on your shoulder. But what I have you here with me today is to talk about a serious topic in entrepreneurship, personal development, and what we need to do to look forward in the future versus just the quick, write your goals down three times a day, you know, things like that. So I think you have a wealth of knowledge, and I want to share you with my audience as well as share that content with my audience. So thank you so much for joining me today, Fab.
Okay, thank you, Stacey. Thank you for having me.
Well, you know, what we're going to do is just go right into it. Let me get a brief history of who you are and how did you get to this point? I know you're an author, but you tell our audience who you are, give them a clearer picture.
Yeah, well, basically, I am quite unique individual, as you can hear from my accent. My accent is British, but my name is Italian, and there's a reason for that. My father was Italian, my mother English. I was born in the UK. I lived in the UK for a number of years, also over in the US. And then I moved to Italy and went to an international school. I did about 20 years in Italy, then moved back to the UK, studied to become a pilot in the US and over in the UK. Then started my career as a pilot, as a private jet pilot. Mm-hmm. And so I did that for about 5 years before I joined the first airline. But during my private jet flying years, I also had the opportunity to start selling aircraft. I also helped manage a private jet brokerage. I helped manage a flight operations department. I also helped manage a private jet terminal, doing marketing for the terminal and that. So I gained a lot of experience around flying.
Right.
Even though the flying wasn't much during that time, and we're talking in the early 1990s when there was a bit of a crisis economically and that, so people were selling their jets instead of buying jets. Mm. And I was, you know, new kid on the block, didn't have much experience. I just came straight out of flight school. But, you know, I managed to do a few hours and get my hours up on jets and meet a few interesting people and work my way into the first airline job, which is what I was aiming for. I flew for a number of airlines, and then I got to a point in my life where I wanted more. I kind of figured out that I had more talent in me than just flying a plane. So it just didn't make sense for me to just use one talent. Right. And funny, because I was teaching Sunday school on one Sunday, and I was teaching the parable of talents. And the parable of talents, and as I was teaching it, it dawned on me that I was just using one talent. And I was probably robbing my family of a better lifestyle.
Wow.
So, well, you know, I need to do something different. So, you know, I came in with my wife. We had a chat about, you know, what I'd done in the past and what, and we came up with, why not combine my passion for aviation and my passion for business, those two talents, put them together and create a business. So we left the Middle East where we were at the time. And we moved back to England, and I set up Tyrus Wings to sell aircraft. So we started with selling aircraft and leasing aircraft.
Yes.
In the private jet field, we did some commercial aircraft as well. And now we're just morphing ourselves this year into private jet management as well, as a way of retaining our clients and giving an extra service to our clients. Because a lot of the people we deal with are first-time buyers. I mean, more and more people today are looking to private jet travel or buying their own jet. Because with terrorism and that, and the way business is going, I mean, today, the name of the game is speed.
Yeah.
Whoever gets to a deal quicker, whoever gets into a market first, is going to win. And so one of the things I've been telling people lately, and also in interviews with the media and that, is if you look at aviation over the last 15, 20 years, since Concorde was retired, air travel has got slower.
Yeah.
Not only because we don't have supersonic air travel anymore, but also because of security in airports, you have to turn up 3 hours before your flight.
Yep.
And you go through TSA security and, ma'am, take your shoes off and take this, or you can't take this, you can't take that. And, you know, it's very stressful. And because of all this, there's an increase in delays, an increase in the number of bags being lost.
Yeah.
Imagine you get out on a business trip and you've got all your clothes in there for your business trip, your equipment, and suddenly that bag goes to Bangkok and you go to LA.
It happens more than you know.
Yeah. So I mean, you know, so more and more people are looking to private jets. Now, a lot of people think it's expensive, but it isn't. Because the way you have to look at it is not like how much is it going to cost me to buy a jet? How much is it going to cost me to operate the jet? Mm. All you have to look at is what opportunities is the jet going to give me that I don't have right now? And a lot of people don't know is that, for example, in the United States, there are only 500 airports which are serviced by the airlines. There's another 4,500 airports.
Wow.
So you may be going to a meeting in Dallas, and there's actually a smaller airport closer to your meeting than the main airport.
Wow.
So why not go in there, get off, go and do your meeting. And the beauty of the private jet, you can drive up to the airplane, get out of the car, straight onto the plane, and in the air. It takes time. Compared to the 2 to 3 hours it takes now going through the main airport, hoping that there's no, hoping and praying there's no delay.
Right.
Because, you know, that's another problem that.
Well, you know what? Coming from the airline industry as well, Fab, I couldn't agree with you anymore. And even as a traveler myself, I see myself looking at this, my watch, more than, you know, more than anything. I'm being delayed. The business, you know, I feel like I can't accomplish anything. 3-4 hours, I'm being put on standby for the next flight. The bag is gone. So I could imagine what you're talking about, speed, and you're talking about getting into markets faster, and you're talking about your bags in Bangkok. I could see how opportunities are lessened without traveling private. I could see that. And I could see in the future where it's going to go.
Yeah, I mean, you see, the thing is, Stacey, a lot of people, when they call me, they get their CFO on the line, okay? And the CFO starts, wants to know the numbers, okay? And, and a lot of the times, you look at the numbers, you say, it just doesn't make sense for me to spend $25 million on buying a jet and then $1.5 million operating it a year. Because, you know, right now, we're only spending $600,000 on air travel.
Right.
But, you know, I went to a lecture a few years ago with a Harvard business professor, Clayton Christensen. He's written a number of books, and he's very famous for his books on innovation. And he said, I'm a Harvard business professor. So when someone comes to study business at Harvard, I teach them. And it's my fault and my colleagues' fault that today a lot of companies are managed from the balance sheet. Because if you manage from the balance sheet, innovation is never going to happen.
Mm.
In order for innovation to happen, it takes someone visionary. And Richard Branson says this often. He says, I sit around the table sometimes with my advisors and they run all the numbers and I listen to them. And then I turn around and I say, screw it. Let's do it.
Yes, yes. Yeah,
and he doesn't always get it right.
Right,
he doesn't always get it right. But you know, in order to sort of, and so with a private jet, I mean, initially I talk numbers to people, and yes, if you're doing so many hours, then you're, and then I soon realized as I was speaking to more and more private jet owners that a lot of these people are visionaries. I mean, Grant Cardone, who we both know.
Yes.
Grant, I bought my first jet. I'd never chartered before. And my first year I did 250 hours. And it's the best investment I've ever made.
Yeah.
Because it's opened up doors that otherwise wouldn't open. And so that's the thing. It's a tool. It's I rate it as the ultimate 21st century business tool.
I agree with it. Yeah, I mean, I agree with it because, you know, first of all, we had a previous conversation. And when we talk about companies like this and, you know, whatever, you're looking for the future, you're looking for innovation, you're looking for technology, but then you get these old mentalities, old kind of way of doing things where it's real estate, where it's, you know, write your goal, personal development. I'm interested because you have a book coming out in the near future, right?
Yeah.
It's Need for Speed.
Correct. Yeah, the Need for Speed.
And we spoke a little bit about speed. Now, what do you see forward thinking as a visionary for the future when it comes to business? Where is business? What are the trends? What are the markets? Because this type of information currently is being held back. And I want to definitely outflow this information.
Yeah, well, first of all, we have to realize today that, I mean, the big game changer in business over the last 20 years has been the internet.
Yes.
Okay. The internet allows me and you, you're in Philadelphia, I'm here in Manchester in the UK, and we're doing a conference over, it's been broadcast over YouTube all over the world. People watching from India, from Japan, from Gibraltar, from Germany, from Los Angeles, from Edmonton in Canada.
Yes.
I mean, people from all over the world are watching this, okay? You know, the world internet has basically opened up your computer to the world. I mean, I always tell people, my wife buys dresses for my daughter, who's 9. She doesn't go to the store downtown. She buys them on eBay from China.
The market really is anywhere at any time, any place.
Exactly, exactly. Yes. So you have to understand how technology is changing the game.
Yeah.
Okay. And it's speeding everything up. Okay. So another thing we have to look at is, for example, educational systems.
Yeah.
Now, a lot of the biggest problems today is young people graduate from school, they spend a ton of money on college, they graduate from university, they go into the workforce, and they haven't got a clue.
Yeah.
Now, is it their fault? No, it's the schooling system. Because unfortunately, the schooling system is way behind, at least the Western world, way behind the working world. Okay. Now, interestingly enough, if you take Singapore, Singapore over the last 15 to 20 years, Singapore 20 years ago was a very poor country. They decided that in order to change the economy, they needed to change the schooling system.
Mm.
So they changed their schooling, and Finland did exactly the same thing.
Yeah.
So these two countries have changed their schooling system. They've now got a very, very cutting edge school. Singapore's schooling system is the number one in the world. If you look at the top 10 to 15 nations, school systems,
yeah,
the top five are all countries in the Far East.
Yeah.
Singapore, Hong Kong, Japan, South Korea. So now fast forward 15, 20 years, you know, and they're all into science, technology,
math.
And that's where things are going. Artificial intelligence after the internet is going to be the next big game changer. So if you've got kids, you've got to get them into technology. If you're an investor, you need to start to look for those sharp young 20-year-olds that are developing the new robot. And you need to be investing in those people. And where is most of that happening? That's happening in the Asia Pacific region of the world. So we're talking West Coast United States and Canada. Vancouver is becoming more and more a place. Vancouver, and it's slightly inland from Vancouver, there's a city there called Kelowna. Uh-huh. And Kelowna is a place that not many people know about, but there's a lot of top companies starting there. There's a lot of artificial intelligence stuff going on there. A lot of the film industry is moving there. Film studios are going out there. So there's a lot of happening in British Columbia as well as Silicon Valley. And then you cross over the Pacific into Japan, yep, South Korea, Vietnam. That's another place where there's a lot of young people that are getting into technology and robotics. Singapore government have invested a lot in robotics lately. So this is where it's happening. Where it used to all happen in Europe, and Europe kind of used to be the place for innovation.
Yeah.
Europe is losing it. And I'm European, and I'm telling you, Europe is losing it big time. We've got a kind of a sort of an invasion here with these people from the Middle East.
Right.
And this is creating a lot of unrest.
Right, of course. Region.
Yeah, and the whole political situation now, and that's another thing you've got to look at. I mean, here in Europe, we've had the UK decided to Brexit and leave the European Union.
Yes.
The European Union is eventually going to collapse, and it's going to happen sooner than later because communism and socialism doesn't work.
No, absolutely not.
And I'll tell you an interesting story, Stacey.
Yes.
When I flew into Berlin as a pilot on a Boeing 737, the very first time, this was just after the collapse of the Berlin Wall, I'm flying in, and I look, and you could see it from the air, the contrast, and you could see it with your eyes between East Berlin and West Berlin.
Wow.
The difference between communism and Western society.
Wow.
In the architecture of the buildings. And coming from the air, and as you're getting closer to the ground, these buildings get bigger and bigger, and the contrast is even bigger and bigger. And seeing it from the air, it was just absolutely amazing and eye-opening. And you could just see with your own eyes, communism doesn't work because
right,
it takes creativity out of man.
Right. That's true. No, you're absolutely right. And I agree with that. And I always said, you know, growing up, I was like, well, why do people love it? Right. Because I didn't understand it.
They don't know it.
Right. So my question is, because the contrast is very stark, and you could, and now we know that the world is smaller with technology and even faster with, companies like yours, Tyrus Wings, get there very quickly and do what you have. I pulled up in the background when you were talking, the top 11 school systems, best school systems in the world. And you're absolutely right. Finland, New Zealand, and we do have on here Singapore. Now, as an
interesting enough, Stacey, Canada is number 10.
Let's see here. Canada, I didn't go down the list all the way, but let's see. Finland, there we have it. And boom, Canada. Boom. Love
now,
it.
Interesting thing I discovered. Now, listen to this one, because this I put in my book, The Need for Speed. When I saw this thing of the schooling system,
yes,
I then looked at the best airports in the world. And you know the top 10 airports in the world? It's nearly exactly the same countries are on the list.
Mm.
So I thought to myself, what's the relationship between airports and the education system. Now, do you know that the number one airport in North America for the last 7 years running, you know which one it is?
I'm going to guess. In America, in North America.
In North America, which includes Canada.
Okay. Is it Toronto?
It's Vancouver.
Vancouver. And you mentioned it. And Vancouver is on the list. And you mentioned that small town, Kelowna, next to it. You're saying that Vancouver is moving into the next Silicon Valley for forward thinkers and minds like that.
Well, also, we have to look at the other thing. I mean, Donald Trump has been elected president of the United States.
Yes.
He has completely rocked the boat politically.
Yes, absolutely.
Across the world, okay? Now we have an entrepreneur in the White House. Not a politician. He's an entrepreneur.
Yes.
He doesn't care what other people think.
Right. Okay?
And his goal is to build America and build business and help businesses thrive.
Well, we're behind.
Some people don't like him. Some people think he's this, that, the other. But I mean, at the end of the day, if he does lower taxes and he does eliminate a lot of regulation, the economy is going to kickstart. And not only the American economy, the world economy.
The world economy, because the American economy used to be synopsis. You know, it's a synonym with the world economy. But I feel that... you know, we're behind. We're behind. Look at these countries, you know? So I like anyone that's forward thinking to get this, to get our world moving again, to get our country moving again, to stimulate that side of it. Because now you're telling me I have to move to Vancouver in order to get that mindset.
I mean, there's a lot going on in Silicon Valley. I mean, one guy I really like is Elon Musk.
Of course.
And Elon Musk is someone to follow. Because that man is an absolute genius. I mean, he's this whole technology thing with the Tesla cars, SpaceX, taking people into space, wanting to colonize Mars, and all these wacky ideas. But, you know, the guy switched on. I've driven a Tesla. I went and drove a Tesla last year. I mean, that car is super innovative. I mean, I think they have to increase the battery life in the endurance on the battery. I mean, once they get the electric car up to 500 miles with one full charge, then you go. But I did speak to somebody recently in California that's developing something that will automatically charge a car battery as it goes.
Wow.
Now, if he can get that up, and eventually we're going to see this over the next couple of years, have an auto-charging battery, whether it's done with solar panels on the car or whatever, but, you know, there'll be a way of the car to regenerate itself as it goes along.
I'm sure. You have
100% charge all the time. Wow. We're now looking at flying cars.
Wow. Okay?
In Dubai, July this year, in Dubai, and Dubai is a very technological city. If you've ever been to the Middle East, Dubai is a place to go and have a look at. There's a lot of innovation in Dubai. It's very I call it New York in the desert, because it literally is New York in the middle of the desert.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, the technology they've put into Dubai is amazing. And they're looking at having automatic flying cars. So basically, you go on an app, and you say to the app, it's like Uber, but you're calling a drone. And the drone will land on the roof of your building. You'll get into the drone. There's no driver. And it will take you where your app tells you. You say, I need to go to this address. And the drone will fly you there.
What company is that? Do you know the name of that?
It's I don't know the name of the company, but this drone is being flown. And I did a blog about this the other day, talking about drones.
Tell us your blog. Is it on Tyrus Wings?
It's on LinkedIn. If you go on LinkedIn and you type in my name, I've written about 253 blogs about aviation and that.
I'll put that in the show notes for you guys. I'll put that in the show notes because that's good information. Now we're being taught things that we need to learn to move in the future. I think we're kind of stuck as entrepreneurs. Now, what do you think would be the best source of learning, because I know you kind of you read a book earlier on. I think it's the foundation of something, and for you to learn about the trends of the future, you know, what book was that? I want to give a resource to our comfort killers.
I wrote Your Attitude Determines Your Altitude. That was written back in 2005, so a few years ago. I'm actually rewriting that book right now, and it will be out in a new edition, very new. We may even change the title, I don't know, in September, because a lot has changed since 2005.
Right.
So it needs some updating. But it's interesting because I wrote that book, and the core message of the book is people were shut in a cube, okay? And this cube was kind of limiting people. And it's all about, one of the big problems today in the self-help industry, for example, is the fact that it's all about teaching people how to make a ton of money.
Yeah. Okay?
And so everybody's looking at these people with a lot of money and they think, oh, I need to make a lot of money. And if you don't make a lot of money, you feel bad. Now, my approach is different. My approach is, let's try and figure out what talents you have. What talents do you have? And what can we do to help you develop your talent? And it could be playing the violin. It could be playing golf. It could be painting pictures. I don't know. Every one of us comes to Earth with a number of talents. The problem is, the way society is rigged today, it's all about me comparing myself to the guy next door. If you're a young person in school, yeah, or a woman comparing herself to her neighbor, oh, she's got beautiful hair, I don't. Yeah. Oh, she's got a nicer dress than me. And a guy say, oh, he drives a faster car than me. He's got more money than me. And there's all this comparison thing going on all the time, which is wrong. Because at the end of the day, we need to look within. And if we keep looking without, we don't have time to think within. Well, let's start thinking within. Who am I? What talents was I given? And what should I be doing with my talents instead of focusing on other people's talents? Yep. Try to develop talents that you don't have. I mean, I can train all day long in boxing.
Yeah.
I go and fight one of the top boxers in the world. You know, I'll probably last 10 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
This is not my talent. So but if everybody around me says to me, Fab, you need to get into boxing. And then I put all my time into training to be a boxer and then go on the ring and I get knocked out in 5 minutes and maybe lose my teeth in the process. And then I feel a failure.
Right.
And
that wasn't your talent.
Yeah. I mean, I think people are a failure. You know when someone's a failure? When they have talent, they don't discover it and they don't develop it. That's when you're a failure. If you're trying something that's not you and it doesn't work, that's not a failure. You're just doing the wrong thing. So start looking within. Try and just and the way to do that is to think back when you were a child.
Yeah.
First 7, 8, 9 years of your life. What were you interested in? What naturally were you interested
in? Trying to, yep.
Yeah. And because chances are the answer to your question about what talents do I have? And I think a lot of this, I think children are a lot closer to life before life. And their memory is more intact, they're more creative, and then they get into the schooling system and it boxes them in and stops them from being great. I mean, in a classroom, when you want to speak, you have to put your hand up. And I remember an incident that happened to me. I was in third grade and the teacher starts talking about, Mrs. Bisbee, her name was, she starts talking about the planets. And so she's saying, oh, they've got these planets in the solar system and then we've got these stars and there are probably other planets around these stars. Yeah. So I immediately put my hand up and I said, excuse me, Mrs. Bisbee, if there's all these planets around the sun and we live on one of them and there's other stars and around these stars there are other planets, there's probably other people living on these other planets. You know, everybody laughed. Everyone in my class laughed. Until the teacher turned around and said, Fab, that's a very clever question. Immediately everybody shut up. Now I asked a different question. And, you know, asking yourself certain questions is important. When I went to aviation college, I graduated from aviation college and everybody wanted to be a pilot. They gave you a basic education, which allowed you to then go in and get your pilot's licenses. And so everybody was trying to get in the Air Force and be sponsored by an airline for their training. And when nearly everybody failed, including myself, I didn't get in the Air Force. I didn't get an airline to pay for my training.
Yeah.
I said to myself, okay, how much money do I need to become a professional pilot? And it was like $100,000. So I said, okay. So all my classmates, most of them said, I don't have $100,000. Now this is my dad. So I'll go and work in a bank. Now I could have said the same thing.
Yeah.
I asked myself a different question. I said, what do I need to do to find the money?
Woo. So you're asking yourself different questions than that been asked when you were smaller, when you were in middle school, elementary school. You already knew that asking yourself and you just kept that with you. So you're asking yourself different questions. You see opportunity where people see a stark roadblock.
Yeah, and this is where creativity is really important. And this is where I'm very critical of the schooling system to the extent that my four children, my oldest is 16, have never attended school.
Mm.
They haven't attended school one day of their life.
Yeah.
We've homeschooled them from day one. And the main driver for them is learning languages because they can communicate with different people. Learning about technology and learning about creativity, how to be creative. Discover your talents, develop them, and be creative. So asking questions is being creative. It's not about all the books that you read and all the courses that you've done. I mean, an intelligent person is someone that asks questions that other people don't ask. And, you know, every innovation in society has happened because someone asked a different question. The Henry Fords of the world, the Thomas Edisons of the world, the Wright brothers. I mean, they all asked themselves a different question. And then as a result of that, they went out looking for the answer.
Well, you know what? That's funny because, you know, I could see how in any period, someone asked an absurd question and the entire world was either laughing at them, throwing stones at them. It didn't make any sense. And I could see how creativity comes from asking questions. I have a great book on creativity here. But I wanted to pull away three things that you said that you're doing, you're homeschooling your kids, and it's three things that you want them to focus on. And I think it's great for us entrepreneurs to move forward and focus on language.
Yeah.
So we could, you know, we could speak, so we could communicate, technology and creativity. So would you put that as the three main things as an entrepreneur should focus on now?
Yeah. And also, Stacey, the other important fact, and I've learned this lesson myself, investing in a couple of startups in the last 3 or 4 years, which failed. And they didn't fail because it was not a good idea. They failed because the wrong people were involved.
Yeah.
I invested in the wrong people. So the people are far more important than the actual invention, product, company, whatever it is you're doing.
Yeah.
Okay. And what you need to look for in people is, can they stand on their feet? I mean, can they think on their feet? So can they change quickly? How do they read the market? Okay. Can they read the market quickly? Are they good with technology? Are they good with communicating with people? If they get knocked down, do they get up right away? Do they ask themselves different questions? If something doesn't work, do they sit there and go, oh, it didn't work? Or do they say, okay, wait a minute, this didn't work. What have I learned? And now let's move on. If you look at the successful sports teams, a successful sports team, if they lose, they never lose. They learn. Yeah. The coach will bring the players in the next day and say, okay, guys, we lost 3-0 yesterday. Let's have a look at some of the mistakes that we made. What have we learned? Great. Move on. Let's change
that. Move on. I mean, you imagine a sports team being humbug like some folks of the world, and they just won't even get out to play the next day.
I mean, some sports teams spend a week. They spend a week talking about, oh, we lost because the referee was against us.
Right.
And they go on and on and on for a week.
Right.
Complaining about it. You know what? It's not going to change the result.
So, I mean, you know, I agree with that 100%. And now that I look at it with your big goal of, you know, just eliminating commercial travel, you know, it's when it... And what do you see as far as the wealth? Where is the wealth in the world moving? Is it moving with the entrepreneurs around technology? Is real estate, is all those things that we talk about as an entrepreneur, even this company that I have, you know, I slap people in the face and I say, hey, listen, this is what you need to do to move forward in life, motivation, and then working with people such as you. Where do you see we need to focus, okay? Most of our time as young entrepreneurs, if we're not technological, right? We just want to invest in the right places. We want to be around the right people. But some people we've been taught it. We've been taught it to sit in that box. But we want to move out. We're not creative. We're not technological. What do we do?
Well, okay. So first of all, if you're not technological, that does not stop you from investing in technology. Mm. You just find some smart techno geeks and invest in them. What you need to get your head around is what this technology is actually going to do and figure out if it's going to be useful for the world. So those are the things you should be thinking. So real estate, I still think, is going to be an investment, which will always be an investment, a good one. Obviously, be very careful where you invest. So, you know, I'd look at the geopolitical situation of wherever you're putting your money if you're in real estate. So, I mean, we talked about Vancouver earlier. We talked about Kelowna, for example. We talked about Singapore. I mean, where obviously technology is the big driver. Okay. So if you see, for example, a company going to set up an office in a certain location to do with technology, they're going to be employing a lot of people. And those people are going to need schools for their kids. They're going to go shopping. They're going to buy groceries. They're going to buy cars. You know, and I talk a lot about the aerotropolis. Mm-hmm. And this is where there's the connection between airports and schooling systems.
Mm.
Okay. Now, why is it that Vancouver, why is it that Singapore, for example, are one of the top airports in the world? Also, Helsinki Airport in Finland is one of the top airports in the world. Wow. Now, what's happened there? Now, the aerotropolis phenomenon is something really, really interesting to understand for an entrepreneur today. Because what the Aerotropolis is you take Dubai. Now, Dubai used to be a shipping village in the 1960s. Then suddenly an English company went in there. Some guy decided, he figured out maybe there was oil. He drilled. He struck oil. Okay. Mm-hmm. Once the oil had been discovered, they then obviously were going to create jobs. But they discovered that the main thing they needed to do was develop the airport. So they put a lot of money, the oil money, into the airport. They developed this airport. And then obviously, when you build an airport, you need people that need to work at the airport. Engineers, check-in people, pilots, flight attendants, whatever. So as you build the airport, then you need to start to build a city around the airport where the people that work at the airport can live. And this is how Dubai was developed. Yeah. Another aerotropolis is Panama. Now, Panama City is another interesting place because as more and more people connect on the internet, then these goods have to move from A to B to C to D, and they're going to need aeroplanes or drones. Okay. Now, Amazon is investing heavily into drones. So drone technology is going to be a big thing of the future. I mean, I was watching a video the other day, very interesting. You place your order on your phone for a pair of shoes with Amazon, and it leaves the Amazon depot on a drone.
Yep.
You put this Amazon logo in your back garden, and the drone flies along. It recognizes your address. It recognizes the landing point, and it lands straight on the logo.
Yep.
And it advises you on your app. Okay, the Amazon drone's landing with your new shoes.
I saw it. I saw that video. Amazing.
Yeah. So, I mean, this is the future. So going back to cities and locations and technology and markets and everything, I'd look at those airports, look at those places where those countries where the schooling system is really good. But the other option would be to homeschool your children. Homeschooling today is a lot easier than it was 15, 20 years ago because of technology. You can get your kids schooled remotely through computers, sometimes automatically through sites like Khan Academy, TED conferences, YouTube, everything's on there. I mean, my son repairs computers, not computers, sorry, cell phones. And he learned to repair cell phones on YouTube. So he went on YouTube, he discovered how to, then he went on eBay, bought the parts, and started repairing. So he opens this phone. He knew nothing about electronics. He learned about electronics by taking his phone to pieces, learning from YouTube what each part of the phone did, ordering the bits that didn't work.
Wow.
The phone, and now it works.
And it's like a eureka. It's like I did that. My hands did that, and I learned. And how old is he, by the way?
Well, my oldest son is 16, and he's doing YouTube. He's got YouTube channels.
Yeah.
With technology, but he likes film and he wants to get into the film industry and become a film director. In fact, I'm a big Star Wars fan, and I named him. His name is Benjamin Obi-Wan, as in Obi-Wan Kenobi is his second name.
Yeah.
And I didn't know that Star Wars was going to become big again when he was 15 years ago.
Right.
But anyway, he's big into Star Wars and that, and he wants to direct one of the future Star Wars films. That's one of his goals.
Wow, and he's going to do it. I mean, you know, and you're right. We put a YouTube. I learned so much from YouTube, just clicking what I want. I believe information and education has changed. And you're right. The places that change with that technology will stand ahead of the curve. And that's the place we need to look at.
Yeah, the big markets now, as I said, that Asia-Pacific region. I mean, Africa, to a certain extent, is growing. There's a lot of new fashion designers and also musicians coming out of Africa.
Yeah.
I mean, Africa is a very interesting continent. I've been there a number of times. There's a lot of creativity there.
Yeah.
And that's because these people haven't been... This whole thing about comparing yourself to your next-door neighbor doesn't happen in Africa.
Yeah.
Okay? People are more about themselves, and they figure out what they're good at. And so a lot of the new fashion stuff that's coming out is coming out of Africa.
Yeah.
Not just one country. Kenya, it's coming out of Congo, it's coming out of South Africa. So you've got all these new fashion designers which are conquering the fashion world. I think the new Giorgio Armani is not going to be Italian, it's going to be from Africa.
Right. I agree.
Africa has its challenges because, you know, they don't have much of a road infrastructure. The airports need to be developed. And there's a lot of stuff that needs to go on there to develop it, which is why I would aim more at the Asia Pacific region. I mean, and I'll tell you an interesting thing. A friend of mine has a friend of his who's a professor at University in California, and he said, you know, 25 years ago, my class was full of Japanese students, and if I said to the Japanese students, "This is green," they would write, "This is green."
Mm.
Today, my classroom is full of Chinese students. And if I say to them, "This is green," hands go up. I said, excuse me, professor, why is it green?
Amazing.
So, I mean, now this tells you a little story. Now, I'm not saying the Chinese are better than the
Japanese. Yeah.
And Japan is coming back again. I mean, the problem with Japan and also China to a certain extent is the demographics, where they're not having that many children.
Right.
So this is where you see a country like Vietnam is one to keep your eye on.
Yeah.
When you talk Far East, it's always Japan and China. I mean, President Trump met with the Japanese Prime Minister a few weeks ago. He's meeting with the Chinese President in the next few days.
Yeah.
But what about Vietnam? Now, Vietnam, if you look at the demographics in Vietnam, they have a lot of young people. Okay? So they're having more children. So, you know, they've got more of a future from a demographic standpoint, and they're investing in technology. So, you know, that's one to look at. South Korea is another one. I mean, you've got Samsung, Hyundai, a lot of interesting tech companies have come out of South Korea, and these companies are developing some very interesting technology. I mean, if you go to South Korea, Seoul is a very, very high-tech
city. Yeah.
All the young people in their 20s, they're all into technology, smartphones, computers, internet. I mean, they understand technology big time. And the interesting thing is, if you look at the Chinese entrepreneur 20 years ago, basically what they did is they came over to Europe, they saw the ideas that we had in Europe or in the US, mm-hmm. and they went back to China and they copied it.
Yes.
Today, what the Chinese have done, because they've understood that their massive labor force is decreasing in numbers,
yes,
also being substituted by artificial intelligence. Today, a robot can do the work that 10 men used to do 20 years ago. So a lot of wealthy Chinese decided to send their children over to America, Canada, Australia, and the UK to study. The universities here in England, like also in the US, in Vancouver, they're flooded with Chinese students.
Yeah.
I lectured at Lancaster University a couple of years ago on entrepreneurship. They called me up. They wanted me to tell the Tyrus Wing story.
Yes.
So I went and lectured to 35 students. And the lecture is available on YouTube if people want to have a look at it. And most of my audience were from China. Now, they obviously speak Mandarin Chinese. They also speak fluent English. They're learning the Western ways. But above all, these young people are getting some work experience over in the Western world. Then they're going back to China and they are creating.
That's it.
Before, the Chinese didn't create. Now they're creating.
Yes.
So these Asian guys in Japan, in Vietnam, in Singapore, in China, and now getting into creativity mode. Once upon a time, creativity used to come from Europe. Now, as I said, fashion industry is coming out of Africa.
Right.
And to some extent, Japan. There's a lot of fashion designers in Japan, which are very trendy. But you mean technology is coming out of Asia, and also to a certain extent, the US and Canada.
Yeah.
And the beauty of the US and Canada is you've got a lot of people that move there. You've got a mix of nationalities and that. And the environment in British Columbia, what they did, and this is 5-6 years ago, they eliminated a lot of regulation. I had a meeting with some of their top political people, which was 2 years ago, and they said to me, what we've done here, is we've eliminated a lot of regulation to create an environment for entrepreneurship.
I love that. Innovation, and you got to watch the regulation. So I think that's the final piece to our puzzle here.
Yeah,
is the regulation. First, we're checking out the Airtropolis. And you know, when you said that, you reminded me of even biblical times where the water is where the tropolis would be around.
Yeah, because the canal, boats. Yeah, because it was boats.
To
yeah.
move things. So now it just changed. And I love that, you know, it just changes with technology or what's happening. But you could kind of foresee something when you have a baseline. So what's next? What's next for you and Tyrus Wings?
Well, we, as I said, we're starting to do aircraft management, which is good. So we've got a number of jets coming in. We're crewing them. We've got a very unique way of doing it. I mean, my motto is the private jet needs to stay private. So what do I mean by that? I mean that if you buy a jet, don't charter it out to Tom, Dick and Harry.
Yeah.
Because it has to be private. It's your plane.
Yeah.
Okay. The other thing is, don't have your pilots fly around in flashy uniforms, because guess what? When they turn up in the hotel, people always go and speak to pilots.
That's true.
The first question they ask you is, what airline do you fly for?
That's
and
true.
If you say, I don't fly for an airline, I fly for a private jet, now you've got their attention.
Yeah.
And you don't want attention on your pilots.
Yeah.
Because you're moving from A to B to C to D, you need to keep it private. And so this is important. So we're coming out with that kind of message. The other thing I've been talking to people about, and I've been putting out there, is a statistic that not many people know about and people keep very quiet about, is that the private jet industry, if you fly on a private jet, you've got 5 times more chance of crashing and dying than if you fly with the airlines. This is, the Flight Safety Foundation went out there, they analyzed all these accidents that private jets have had, all these airlines, and they figured out, they came out with the data, there's 5 times more accidents with private jets and private aviation than there are in the airlines. Now, the question is why?
Well, why? I mean, I know American Airlines has about 2,000 to maybe 3,000 jets.
Yeah, but now, I having worked as a pilot in both worlds,
yeah,
having seen the way they function and dysfunction to a certain extent, I mean, the problem with the airline, you've got a lot of pilots and a lot of crew. You have to standardize things, okay? You're carrying a lot of people. Yes. So if a plane crashes, you've got 200 families knocking on your door for money for the insurance.
That's true.
So they have to get things right. With the private jet, a lot of the times, a lot of crashes happen because the boss pushes the pilot. So the pilot says, oh, you know, it's too foggy. We can't land. We've got to go to another airport. No, no, you got to land.
I got this thing to do. I need to be down on the ground. Yeah.
And so, and the pilot doesn't want to, you know, go against the boss because otherwise he'll lose his job. And
right.
So he then puts himself into a situation. Now, 54% of accidents could have actually been avoided if the pilot executed a go-around. A go-around is when you're coming into land, you decide it's not safe, you decide to go back
go
up.
Go around, yep.
So you go around. So 54% of accidents could have been avoided if the pilot had done a go-around. Now, you know, I know friends of mine have done go-arounds in private jets, then when they landed, they got sacked. They got fired. Because the boss got scared, or his wife did, or one of their guests got afraid. So I said to all my pilots, I said, guys, and all my clients, they come in, we're going to manage the airplane. I say, now, sometimes the pilot needs to do a go around.
Yeah.
What I want you to think, if he does a go around, don't think, oh, we're going to die. Think, we didn't die. He's keeping me safe.
I love that.
Okay. And so I say this, when you step on that airplane, the captain is in charge. You're no longer in charge.
Yeah.
If I hear you try and push one of my guys, I will rip your management contract out right away and I'll throw your airplane out there and you're on your own.
So in essence, you're kind of regulating your own standards right in Tyrus Wings so that you could remain, you know, you kind of have some regulation there with pilots. It's a very scary thing. I mean, I've been in a holding pattern 4 or 5 time go arounds and I'm glad, I'm thankful that they didn't actually try to land in that storm or whatever. But I love how you've been kind of regulating and standardizing your own approach. My pilot is the boss as soon as you step on the plane.
Yeah, I mean, I'm going very against the mainstream here.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, a lot of people, if they have someone that wants to buy a jet, they'll do anything. They'll do anything to, I mean, I sometimes talk people out of buying a jet. Because for me, it's important that at the end of the day, the jet is a business tool.
Okay.
So I need to get my head around your business. Okay, Stacey, what do you do? What are your goals for the future? Where is your industry going?
Mm-hmm.
And try and figure out what is the best business tool for you airplane-wise.
Yes.
And it may be, I say, you know, Stacey, I don't think you need to buy a jet right now. I think you should lease one for 6 months. Because I think if you lease one, you get all the benefits of private jet ownership without having to outlay the cash. Because in 6 months' time, you'll find yourself in need of a different type of airplane.
Mm.
If you buy that plane now, then we need to sell it in 6 months to buy the other one. It's going to take us a year to sell it. Now you're stuck.
Right.
Okay. So I'm walking away from a nice hefty commission.
Yeah.
Just to, so I prefer to do that. And also with the management, you know that 8 out of 10 people, when I tell them about, because we pay the pilots more money, we put more money into training than most people do. And 8 out of 10 people aren't willing to pay that money.
Yeah.
Oh no, I can do it cheaper somewhere else. Well then go somewhere else.
Right. That's it. That's
the problem. Here we do it our way. And the reason we do it our way is for this, that, the other. If you don't buy into our philosophy, no problem. You're more than welcome to go to our competitors.
I love it. And you know what you just told me is what you said earlier. You said, man, it's about the people. If it doesn't fall back into the people, you're walking away from high commissions. You're making sure that your philosophy is heard because it's about the people. It already has an umbrella vision where we created this culture for the people, and it always ties back. So you're always on purpose, and all the decisions you make are on purpose because of your philosophy. So
yeah, I mean, the people is key, because you see, if you want to retain your clients, if you want your clients to be happy, and if you want your clients to basically go out there and refer you to their friends and family and other business associates, they have to be satisfied with what you've given them.
Absolutely.
Okay? So it's very important to give them what they need and not what they want. Give them a business tool that's going to make them money.
Mm.
Okay? So that then the their finance guy, who will say no to the airplane initially, in a year and a half's time, when he sees that you've opened up this market and that market and the other market, and he sees the money flooding in, and then you can turn around and say, well, you see, if we didn't have the jet, we would have never been able to do that.
Right.
Well, I need to make sure that this jet is going to be a business tool. So the client needs to be educated in how he's going to use this business tool. I mean, you don't necessarily have to always fly on the jet yourself. You can send the jet up to pick a client up and bring him back to your office, to your location. You know what impression you're going to make on that guy if you send a jet out or your helicopter to pick him up?
Yeah.
The chances of you doing the deal are going to increase tremendously.
Exponentially, yeah.
Exponentially.
Yes.
The other aspect is also the pilots and the crew, the flight attendants. It's very important that we get good people. And if that means that particular, I mean, you hire the right people first. And if that pilot isn't necessarily qualified on that type of aircraft, you qualify him. You pay him to school to get that particular qualification.
Yeah.
You have to have the personality of the pilots has to match the personality of the boss.
Yes.
There needs to be that if you're one of these people that keeps, wake up in the morning and decide you need to go to LA and Tokyo in the afternoon, and your pilot's on call all the time, you're not going to go and hire a family man. Because he's going to start, you're calling once, you're calling twice, you're calling three times. I mean, the fourth time he's going to resign.
Yes.
Because you need to go to a wedding or whatever. So you need to keep that balance. And so if the client is one of these people like that, you need, and he only wants to hire two or three pilots, we need to make sure we've got somebody that's single or somebody whose children are already blessed. Yeah.
You know,
understanding really the business of the client.
Yeah.
You have to fit them with the right plane and the right crew. And then on the crew side, the crew need enough time. They need good money and they need time off.
Yeah.
So a lot of our crew fly 2 weeks on, 2 weeks off.
Yeah.
So the 2 weeks on, they're away with the airplane, they do their thing, and then they got 2 weeks off where they can do their family stuff, their hobbies, they go fishing, whatever they want to do. And this is important because, I mean, pilots talk to pilots, and it's probably the best connected people in the world because you fly a lot and you're flying into New York 1 minute, Tokyo the next, and you're meeting other pilots and you go for lunch with other pilots. You meet another crew. It's happened to me many times. They say, where are you guys going for lunch? Oh, we're going to this restaurant. Okay, we'll join you. Then you start talking. And then, how much time do you get off? How much money do you earn? Oh, you're looking for another pilot, are you? I'm not really happy where I am. Any chance of me joining you? You know, you don't want that to happen.
Yeah.
So you want to attract the right guys and you want to keep them. And the way to keep them is to pay them good money, treat them well, and give them good time off. And give them good training as well. Now, obviously, all this is going to cost money. But come on, you just spent $60 million on a plane.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying. It's like, you know, when you look at these opportunities versus the benefits versus what you're saying no to, it makes perfect sense. Do what's right behind the people. You're going to keep them. You're going to attract them. And same thing with your clients. You know, you made this philosophy. You attract the ones that you want and instill that philosophy in them. Fab, I had a fabulous time with you. And I'm not saying that because it's Fab. I'm saying that because I did. Phenomenal. I took tons of notes here. Yep. I love taking notes during our interview sessions because I put something together that's specifically meant for you. And you taught me a lot today. The first thing and second thing and third thing that you taught me was let's look outside of where we are. We may not be looking in the right areas. I love the fact that, you know, you'll pick up and move. You'll pick up your entire family and move because you're looking at the geolocations, you're looking at the surroundings, you're looking at the future, and you've taught me that today. I'm very nimble. I move from place to place. I like to spend time about 3 years, but now maybe I've been looking in the wrong place. Maybe I'm not asking the right questions.
Well, let me summarize this with a little story I invented the other week.
Yeah, definitely.
The parable of the banana.
Tell me about that banana.
Okay, so now, I lived in the Middle East and our maid was from Sri Lanka. And in Sri Lanka, they grow bananas. And the bananas in Sri Lanka are fantastic.
Yeah. Okay.
Now, what happens if I take a banana plant from Sri Lanka and I bring it here to England and I plant it? Mm. What's going to happen?
It's not going to
grow bananas.
Yes. No.
Same. If I take an apple tree from England and take it out into the desert in Saudi Arabia, what's going to happen?
Nothing.
Okay, now, is there something wrong with a banana plant?
Absolutely not.
Is there something wrong with the apple tree?
You made perfect sense.
What's wrong is the environment.
Environment, yep.
It's the same with people. So if you're not developing and growing into what you were designed to do, if you were designed to be a banana or an apple, but you're an apple and you're in the desert, or you're a banana and you're in England, you're not going to grow into a banana tree or an apple tree because you're in the wrong environment. So environment is key. And so you have to put yourself in the right environment. And that may mean a radical change.
That's it.
You have to be brave. You have to be uncomfortable, as you say.
I love it.
It takes to be, you've got to have the guts to become uncomfortable.
Yes.
But put yourself in that environment where you are going to grow and develop the talents that God gave you.
Mm.
What's your next door neighbor? Because if you've been trying to become an apple tree all your life, but you're a banana tree,
never gonna work.
Yeah. So you need to discover what type of tree have you been designed to be, and then put yourself in that environment so that you can flourish and develop that fruit that you were designed to develop.
There you have it. The parable of the banana. Great summary to take us out. The environment is key. I appreciate you so much, Fab. I know you're out there. You're very productive today. You're very busy. I wanted to thank you for taking the time to talk with me today about you, about what you foresee. This is a great nugget for our comfort killers. I know we're going to find many content that we could use, utilize, implement, and actionize today. So thank you so much. I just want to ask you a question. Do you believe that you are a comfort killer, Fab?
Yeah. I mean, many times in my life when I've made major changes, it's been uncomfortable.
Yes.
You know, if you want to grow in life, I mean, when you go to the gym and you pump those weights, it's uncomfortable. But you know, I can't go to the gym for you. I say this to my kids all the time. You want to build mental muscle, you want to build physical muscle, you've got to do it yourself.
I love it.
And it's uncomfortable because you got to push yourself. I mean, I was working with some maths problems with one of my sons the other day, and he burst out crying at one point. He said, "Oh, Dad, I find this difficult." I said, "It's not difficult. You just need to figure out how this is done." So we spent another 20 minutes on working out how the problem worked. And he was doing it on his own at the end of it. He said, "You see?" I said, "The reason why you felt pain and you cried, which is fine, it's because you were pushing yourself outside your comfort zone."
Right.
Something that made you feel uncomfortable, which is why you cried, which is fine. But now how do you feel? Oh, great. If you learned something, now you know how to do these other calculations.
Right.
Yeah, you become a better person. And that's life. You need to push yourself. You know, sometimes it does require doing some wacky stuff, something outside the box, and people will criticize you. And if you've got too many people around you criticizing you, guess what? You're in the wrong environment. You're the banana tree in England. It's raining all the time. It's cold.
That's it.
Go back to Sri Lanka.
That's it. I love you so much, Fab. Thank you again for joining me. Ladies and gentlemen, I am Stacey A. Cross, and there is no E in my name. Until next time, Comfort Killers, all the details will be at the show notes. Fab has amazing books, amazing articles. These things will be outlined for you in the show notes. Thank you again for watching. Those that are listening, thank you. Remember, subscribe to our iTunes channel at Get Uncomfortable Podcast. Thank you. Enjoy your day, Comfort Killers.